Hello, Lorraine. What are we going to talk about today?
Hello. Today we're going to talk about deprived areas and how diverse they are.
What are deprived areas? Are like slums?
Yes, like slums. Slums are one type of deprived areas, we could say like that. But I think it's important for people to understand the context that how deprived areas are emerging in different cities. There are many cities in low to middle income countries, and there is a proliferation of these marginalized groups and neighborhoods that normally lack of resources, or like their living conditions are not optimal when you consider the formal settlements, let's say like this. And there's a lot of issues within academia and try to conceptualize what deprived areas are. But overall, they face similar challenges and have similar characteristics, and that's the way we map them, using these characteristics.
Okay,
similarities, the similarities. And that's the whole point of it, I imagine.
Okay, so I see we have an interview, for instance, with Caroline Hevert, who is mapping slums. Is that what you do as well?
I base myself on their work. So I build upon the mapping slums, like the slums that are already mapped. But from there on, my research is exactly thinking a step forward. So after mapping the slums, you're able to, or we're trying to make the municipalities being able to understand the diversity of those areas and then be able to understand how the differences are also very meaningful when promoting better or more efficient policies.
So in the settlements, what kind of difference do you look into?
We look into the difference, the different features that they present. So we have a pool of features that we include as input of the model. And these features, they are in all the sorts. And we use remote sensing and GIS process like to capture them. And they are proxies of infrastructure, services, density, or in a more remote sensing related topic, texture. So we analyze the pixel and how they are combined, how complex they are among themselves. So I would say if those settlements are more dense, but perhaps further from vegetation or closer to vegetation. We also have proxies of land use. If those areas have more residential or non-residential land use, if the topography is more steep or not, or if it's close to streams, so it depends, and like depend on the type of context that you're evaluating. Because my research was in São Paulo, specifically the city of São Paulo. But when you're changing the concept, when you're transferring this model to another place, these features will also vary. And these variations, they say a lot about the characteristics of this neighborhood. So you may have one neighborhood that is more dense and is closer to a stream and has lack of infrastructure or is further from hospitals, and then another one that is very close to vegetated areas. So this would imply that perhaps these areas are more early stage, in an early stage development, like a stage of this development.
What kind of problem can we solve by using this kind of technique?
We can solve a multitude of problems, to be honest, especially in low to middle income countries. Because when you have, I would say one example, you have one area of the government that work with risk, for instance, and hazard risk. And if you have the type of output that the research provide, so if you have the different characteristics, so the neighborhoods, the deprived neighborhoods with specific characteristics, you can target the policies according to those characteristics and don't stigmatize an entire neighborhood and provide and will be able to provide resources accordingly. So if there's a vulnerable area or perhaps with land use, like mm-hmm. if you want, this neighborhood has more residential land use, maybe the type of infrastructure that's arriving there, maybe for transportation, will be different than an area that is non-residential. So you're having this type of specific characteristics determined that will also help targeting and creating more efficient policies. And that's what it's all about, specifically in low to middle income countries, because the more efficient you are, the less resource you're using and the less like you're decreasing the budget, right? Or staying within the budget.
Okay. Do you have a special motivation to work on that? I mean, did you come to ITC thinking about, well, I want to work with such a project?
And, yeah. I wanted already to work with deprived areas. Like I said, the conceptualize of deprived areas and deprivation is very unstable still in literature, mm-hmm. but slums or informal settlements, I wanted to work with something like that. That would be, that was the goal since the beginning.
Why?
Yeah, because, that's a deeper question, but mm-hmm. I work with a very vulnerable and deprived area also in my bachelor's, mm-hmm. Doing a master plan, in a river that was also a vulnerable area, a river basin. Mm-hmm. And for me, it was just like something hit here in my heart that I just need to keep working with these areas and not really like, I'm an urban planner, so I always want to work with cities overall, but target is a specific marginalized communities. For me, that was something that it was just in my heart. I need to work with that specifically. And I work in my bachelor and I really love it. Like I study it. And then coming here was also something that I wanted as well. And also, to be honest, when I arrived, it was also such an amazing lecturers that I have and other researchers within ITC that also, like during the lectures, during the course, I also just like, okay, that's really what I want to study.
Okay. Well, this is very honorable. And very happy that there are people looking into that. That's very important.
Yeah. There's a lot of researchers here at ITC that do that, but it's not very common overall in other universities. Like that's something that ITC really target, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Do you want to talk a little bit about the technical part of what you've done? So what kind of process do you use? What sort of data sources and things like that?
Okay, that's also something that was very meaningful for me. Since the beginning, I wanted to work with deprived areas and I only want to use open data sources, like open software. That was something that was settled.
Why?
Because for me, that's also, if I saw so many papers during the courses that made amazing work, but only using very high cost data sets. So they were very high resolution that's normally required to have a very good result, mm-hmm. but sometimes you need to work with what you got, right? Mm-hmm. So that's what I was thinking, thinking of the municipalities that already work with in Brazil. So okay. You need to, it's all low budget. So you need to, if you can achieve a good result, that was actually one of the objectives of my research, to explore the model and explore using only open data sources, like this open source approach, in a way that I could get good results even though the data set was not optimal.
Okay.
So it was freely available, but of course there are some inconsistencies, and at the end the results were very, very good. Okay. So it means that you can achieve good results with the data that's already available, so that's okay. Good, like.
Awesome, yeah.
Yeah.
And okay, so you have open data sets, and then what happens?
And then the first part is really like I said, there's a pool of features, so you need to scavenger internet and go into all the available data sources. A very deep preparation and cleaning process, and that's something that takes a while because, like I said, these data sets, they are not amazing. So mm-hmm. you need to prepare this data. And then when
you share what data sources were that?
What do you mean?
What were the data sources that you used? Many or?
Many, yeah. Okay. Like was a pool of 36 features. So there's a lot. But from Landsat, Sentinel, like different satellite sources, but also OpenStreetMap data sources as well. So that's also something that if you're watching and you work with this, you're going to know that there are some flaws. So you need to work on that as well. So this is one of the part of the research that was that took very long, the preparation of the data sets. In the end, it was worth it, thankfully. Yeah. But that was something, it was really an exploration. And then at the end, you have the input prepared, and I would use it to feed a clustering model. So it's a unsupervised machine learning model, which is very known already in for all the people that work with programming. But it wasn't, I didn't see that no one had ever, has ever used for deprivation studies. So people use it for classification of land use. That's very common. But for this specific, I haven't seen. So it's kind of the first work to do so. Yeah.
Okay, incredible. Well, thank you very much for this interview.
Thank you.
Do you want to be a GeoHero as well? Then take the first step and click the subscribe button and then the bell button to always be the first to know when one of our GeoHeroes posts a new video.